Thank you all for being here. I am going to be hosting today. My name is Courtney Dunning. I am the social media lead for PowerShift Network, and my pronouns are they, them. I am a grassroots organizer based out of Arizona, but just now getting settled and rooted in Tiwa territory, which is Albuquerque, New Mexico. I'm really excited to present to y'all these two wonderful folks, May and Jay, who are going to teach us a lot about activist tech security and so much more. So if this is new information for you to be involved in how to keep yourself safe and secure while organizing, I think this webinar is going to be really beneficial to you. And if you have some idea about how to stay safe, but you're looking for a little bit more, I also think this webinar is going to be great for you because May and Jay are just really depthful human beings with a lot of experience in the realm of organizing. And they're here to share their experiences with y'all. Let's see. We are going to take a bathroom break and a little bit less than 45 minutes, which will be, let's see, what is that? 4:15 PT, 5:15 Mountain Standard, 6:15 Central, and 7:15 Eastern time. So don't worry, we're not gonna push all the way through an hour and a half. And then lastly, there is gonna be time for a question and answer. So if you do have any questions, please feel free to stick those in the questions box and I will get to them at the end of the chat, unless there is a really urgent need, I will answer it. All right, cool. This will be recorded. So if you have any friends who can't be here, this will be up on our YouTube and you're welcome to watch it as many times as you like. All right, so that's enough of me in introducing this. If I could introduce Jay and May, y'all can please hop on and tell us a little bit about yourself and your name, your pronoun, where you're calling in from, and what brings you here in this space.
Thank you, Courtney, and thank you everyone for being here. It's been really delightful watching all of the introductions roll in. I'm really humbled by seeing all of the work that you all are doing. My name is May. I am currently located in Coast Salish land in the so-called Seattle area, also sometimes based in occupied Ohlone territories in so-called Oakland, California. I'm just really humbled and grateful for the opportunity to talk with you all about security. My work is primarily on the intersections of prison abolition and environmental justice. I work with a group called the Campaign to Fight Toxic Prisons, and we work alongside incarcerated people, drawing attention to environmental disasters and public health disasters in the carceral state, supporting inside actions, stopping the construction of new facilities, all sorts of things. And what brings me to this is really anxiety. I'm a very anxious person. I have been since I was a kid, and I've found that learning concrete ways to mitigate surveillance is a source of ease for my anxiety. And so that's kind of some of the root of what's driven me to this area of interest recently. And yeah, I'm sure I'll say more later, but that's a little bit about me to start.
Thanks, May, and thanks, Courtney, for that lovely introduction, and the vibe of that music coming in was fantastic. Also, hey everybody, my name is Jay Carmona. You may know me, I served as interim ED of PowerShift Network for a hot minute. I guess it's been a couple years now. And I'm an organizer, started in LGBT anti-war stuff back in the early aughts in the 90s. And I come out of the radical environmental movement in Northern California as well. And I've been organizing for about 17 years, all over movements, a lot of direct action organizing. I specialize in decentralized sort of mass protest movement organizing and mobilizations through my direct action training and that kind of stuff. And I work in technology these days for organizing and help organizations set up technical ecosystems to support all this badass work that folks are doing. I am also located in coastal Salish land. We did not plan that, by the way. We found that out yesterday that we are both, May and I are both in the same area, which is pretty fun. So we have a little heavy West Coast weighted panelists here.
Ooh, thank you all for introducing yourself. I'm super happy that y'all were able to make this webinar today. I've gotten a couple questions from folks in the chat. Cameras are off, so you are not missing anything. You just get to see my face today. And yeah, we'll get started with that. So let's see, I got a couple questions for our panelists today, and we're gonna let this flow like a conversation. So again, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. And then at the end, I'm gonna share a little bit of a resource with you all that was co-created by Jay, May, and myself. And that will be a piece of material resource for you to take away from this webinar. All right, so we know a lot of folks that have joined this webinar are coming here maybe because they're just trying to brush up on some skills, but also, right, like we're experiencing a lot of urgency right now with recent decisions from SCOTUS. And, you know, there's never a better time to get more skilled up in your organizing and learning how to stay safe, because organizing doesn't feel good when you don't feel safe. And safety looks like a lot of different things. It's not just using Signal on your phone. It's not just using Proton Mail. So we're going to get into a little bit of that. And so that brings me to my first question, which is, and this is a question for both of y'all. If you both feel like answering, go for it. We want to hear it all. So what is your knowledge of or direct experience with state surveillance?
So as I mentioned before, and I'll go first, I hope that's okay. May I wanna let you go first next time maybe. So I grew up in the drug war time in Northern California. And for those who are not aware, that's when federal government started dumping a lot of money and militarizing local police forces. And one of those local police forces was located, or several of them were located in Northern California. And it was called CAMP, the Campaign Against Marijuana Production, which was also known as all these cowboy police departments surveilling working class, primarily white folks living out in the boondocks in Northern California in the woods. And there was no oversight, essentially, and they had helicopters and they gave them big guns and night vision goggles and all kinds of fun toys. And so I basically grew up under that directly. And later in my organizing work, when I got to college, we were part of we were put in the Talon database, which for those of you who don't remember that fun times, it's turned out the Pentagon was like spying on local anti-war, little anti-war groups across the country and putting them in a database called Talon and giving these Talon reports. And they called us, so we can talk about threat assessment, right? But they were marking threats in this database and keeping files and tabs and all these anti-war groups. And we were marked as my little anti-war group that I founded in a dorm room at UC Santa Cruz was declared a credible threat to US national security. And the ACLU had to sue to actually see what was being even, you know, collected about these anti-war groups. But that was like experience number two, and it sort of has gone on from there. I have a lot of experience with private security forces as well, informants, you know, all that kind of stuff in my organizing work.
That's real shit, Jay. Thank you for sharing. As for me, I come from a very different background. I grew up in a pretty affluent suburbs. didn't really have to think about state surveillance that much from a class perspective. However, my family was targeted by state surveillance and intimidation since before I was born due to racial reasons. And so I think that that's always like been in the back of my mind. And like I said, I think anxiety, just my anxious nature has caused me to want to learn a lot more about security. Yeah, kind of some similar details as Jay's organizing history, like the group that I work with, FTP, is considered a security threat group by different Department of Corrections. Also dealt with a lot of private security fuckery on front lines and dealt with built for years with people who later were found out to be federal informants. And kind of the combination of all of these things has caused me and the people who I work with just to want to be a lot more careful, to learn more tools to keep ourselves safe. And then finally, I think it's also important to note that I'm disabled. And I think that like embodied experience of chronic pain and disability has informed like ways that I need to keep myself safe, and also informed like a framework of collective care as a form of safety. And I know that we'll talk about that more later, but just wanted to mention as like one of the roots of my interest in this topic.
Thank you both. I think it's important to share experiences of surveillance because they can happen in a lot of different ways and look a lot of different ways for different people who are organizing in different spaces or around different issues. And I think for me, the reason I find it important to talk about surveillance is because I don't see it being talked about enough. So I do hear a lot about security culture, and I hear a lot about different apps to use or, you know, different practices, but a lot of us aren't actually identifying what it looks like to be surveilled. And that can be a really isolating experience for grassroots organizers because it does not feel good to be reminded and really just, you know, in really subtle ways that you're being watched or that you're being targeted or you're being tracked. And we're gonna see that continue to heighten. I think that a lot of us are pretty aware that it's not hard to find our digital footprint in this age, right? Like we do everything on our phones, we do everything on our computers, and we give a lot of information to these devices, and not just devices, but we also give a lot of information to the people around us. So it's important that, you know, if you've ever experienced surveillance, that you find folks to talk to about it, even if that's a therapist, because, you know, it really does impact you psychologically, and those psychological impacts can impact you physically, and they can impact the way that you show up in a space. So it's always important to talk about surveillance and what it looks like. And, you know, we don't wanna give into causing a lot of fear, but also take things seriously, you know, address issues that come up, and don't be afraid to look like crazy, because you're probably not crazy. All right, cool. Thank you all for that response. The second question we have is, what are some ways we can communicate with one another safely? That can be different apps that we use, different platforms, and so on.
Yeah, we can maybe bounce back and forth on this one because I know that Jay and I have kind of different areas of knowledge. I'll start with browsers because I think that's like a really basic one, just like what computer browser you're using. I would recommend against Chrome or Internet Explorer, because Microsoft and Google, as we know, do tons of data tracking, data collection, and sharing information. So as some alternatives, I would suggest, as a very basic one, Firefox. And along with Firefox, you can add different plugins to make it safer. There's one called HTTPS Everywhere, which can encrypt your browsing. So that's like the most basic, I think, user-friendly one. In addition, I personally use Brave, which is also very user-friendly. It has a lot of the same interface and functionalities as Chrome. However, Brave doesn't save your private information. It has built-in ad tracker and malware blockers. And it's just really easy to use. Brave also has a mode that you can use with Tor, which is another example of a browser that you can use for more spicy searches or needs, data needs. Tor stands for the onion router. You can think like Shrek, onions have layers, and Tor is onion. So Tor has layers of encryption. That's how I remember it. So basically it takes whatever information you're exchanging and passes it through different nodes and relays it and encrypts it at each layer. And so that way, when it gets to the end, they don't know where it came from because it went through so many layers of encryption. So that's kind of like a very overarching, like big picture of like, what is Tor? I will say, I don't recommend Tor for everyday use because it's not functional with things like JavaScript and a lot of media players. So I would recommend Brave for an everyday and Tor for more spicy stuff. You can put Brave on your phone. It's really simple to use. And then while you're searching for things on any of those browsers, I would recommend the search engine DuckDuckGo instead of Google. Just because they don't do a lot of the like data collection, data saving that Google does. I'll pass it to Jay for other things.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about threat assessment a little bit later, but just to mention, I approach all this stuff with kind of a harm reduction, you know, orientation, right? And harm reduction teaches us that nothing is 100% safe. Right? And that kind of goes double for organizing, right? So we're really talking about more safe things, safer things, right? We like spectrums, not binaries, right? In so many ways. And not, right, safety isn't some absolute idea, right? We're talking about safer. So it is always safer to separate your specific planning and organizing activities, as May said, that are spicy or spicier, from your like everyday activities, right? So we don't wanna be mixing in spicy and non-spicy like everyday stuff. And because that means that we're leaving a trail of spicy all throughout, right, our lives. So a thing that's good to do is just separate, you know, set up a separate signal chat, right, for your spicy planning, right? And then that makes it easy to remove and delete that signal chat later, right? And we can use our Proton mail for our spicy activities and other, you know, email, whatever we need for our non-spicy or less spicy activities, right? So extra precaution for spicy. And also to remember about, I'm gonna be a little bit more specific here. Remember, so hypothetically, if I disobey a police officer's orders, so this is like really basic know your rights stuff. So say I stay in the street when an officer tells me to leave. That's probably a misdemeanor, right? So, but the little extra spice here is that typically if you and I plan to disobey a police officer, that's a conspiracy and that's potentially a felony, right? So planning with other humans, right? We have levels of spicy here as well. So a great thing to use for planning also is all encryption for everything that we can with our planning and spicy planning activities. So using end-to-end encrypted messaging, especially in communications that involve planning, is really, really important. So basically, what's encryption? So encryption turns your information like into a secret code. That code is only deciphered with like a special key that either you and or the others you share it with have. So end-to-end encryption, also known as E2E, applies specifically to digital communications. And that makes it so that only the recipient, so the people you're talking to and you, the sender, can see and read those messages. So basically when a message is flying through the internet, right? Like we understand that messages don't immediately fly directly to the person, right, that we're sending them to on the internet. It's like the post office, right? Your post office person doesn't go directly to the person that you're sending the letter to. The same thing is true of the internet. So messages fly throughout various layers and places. And that's why we want end-to-end encryption. And some of the most common end-to-end encryption messaging apps are Signal, and WhatsApp has an end-to-end encrypted place as well. And Signal has taken additional care with their encryption. And then Signal additionally, and WhatsApp might also too, WhatsApp users, let me know, but Signal also has disappearing messages. And these will protect you if, so even if you have an end-to-end encrypted messages, if somebody gets a hold of your phone and gets into it, right? Those messages are potentially seeable if they have your physical phone. So if you send disappearing messages, you can potentially be protected if someone gets a hold of your phone physically. And it's really a good practice in general. So especially with spicy things, you don't want the spicy things to, again, like pile up and hang around sitting on your phone, right? Or, you know, in another shared space. And you want your phone encrypted. So drive encryption includes encrypting your hard drive. I have a great link to share with you all that tells you all of the directions for how to encrypt everything, but you can encrypt your phone, you can encrypt your Mac, you can encrypt your Windows. I don't have instructions on me for Linux, but it's totally, totally, absolutely doable. The other super easy things, and then I'll stop, two of them. One is to turn on two-factor authentication basically on everything. And that helps us both with somebody trying to brute force break into your phone, but also with, you know, pesky phishing, hacking, just sort of like the type of commercial hacking that's super prevalent and everywhere, but is not exactly surveillance, except that some folks who are going to surveil you are going to use some of the same ways to try to get to you. So turning on two-factor authentication on everything, and then using a second factor that is not text messaging. So a two-factor authentication is basically if somebody has my password or somebody guesses my password. Basically, for those of you that have Gmail, you might be familiar with this. It asks for a code that comes from your phone or an app or a key, like a YubiKey, which is a fun little piece of plastic that enables you to have a two-factor authentication that's not on your phone or text messaging. And so turning that on and using it for all of your things is going to be really good. And the other one is using a password manager and or using really strong passwords, especially when we share passwords. Especially basically passwords for anything where planning or documentation of spicy things is happening is going to be really super important. So sharing passwords securely and having those passwords stored securely in your files is really important. I use Dashlane. Courtney May, tell us your favorite password sharing mechanisms, but they're password storage tools. Those are going to be really, really key as well. There's also one-time secret. So it's called onetimesecret.com. If you must, this is like your last go-to. Someone's like, I must have this password. You can use this to share it securely. Some of our, you know, friends who are less technically inclined may not get a sharing request from a Dashlane or something like that. They may need something like this. What I do is I'll send them this password in one-time secret, and then I'll change it afterwards as well, just to be extra, extra safe. I'll stop there.
Thank you. I saw a question in the questions about like using Tor, drawing additional attention to ourselves, and I think that can be true, and I will say that that's why we want to use like blended and decentralized approaches to everything, and also not use things when we don't need to. So I think Jay will tell us a little bit about VPNs later, but like additional things that we can do to keep ourselves safe in a combination with what browser, what messaging app we're using is our operating systems. I'll talk about this mostly for computers. There are ways to put different operating systems on phones, but it's kind of tricky and I think maybe beyond the scope of this webinar. But when it comes to computers, I would recommend open source software, just because Mac or Windows, as we know, collect and save information. And so open source basically means that it's free software and that the source code is open to the public. So you can see if you wanted to, or if you know someone who can read code, can see what all is in there and what exactly is happening. So Debian and Linux have a bunch of different distros. For these are definitely not necessary for everyday use, but if you have like sensitive information that you need to carry out and you want a better operating system for that, there's three that I'll recommend. One is Tails, which is an operating system that you can run out of a USB drive. So basically you plug it into your computer, you turn your computer off, you turn it back on, and you load, it will load on an operating system called Tails. And when you unplug it, it doesn't leave any digital footprint on the computer that you're using. So that one is pretty cool. There's another one called Parrot OS, and all of these are open source Linux distros. Parrot OS is also specifically geared towards security. It has a lot of like pen testing, penetration testing functionalities, which is basically a fancy word for like trying to identify and mitigate technical vulnerabilities. So Parrot is good. And then finally, Qubes is another one, which is Q-U-B-E-S. And basically what that does is kind of splits your computer into different operating systems that you can use for different things. So like how Jay was saying, you don't want to keep your everyday personal activities on the same browser or on the same messaging thread or whatever as spicy things. Qubes basically allows you to have a bunch of different operating systems or compartments within one operating system so that if one of them becomes compromised, then the other ones are still okay. So that's operating systems, and I'll pass it back to you, Jay, for VPNs and more.
Oh, I'm interested to hear what you have to say about VPNs. One thing I have to say about VPNs is that not every VPN is created equal, right? So there are some VPNs, and basically you have to kind of do your research and, May, tell us what you use, but you got to really do your research. Any old VPN is not going to work. We really got to find one that has a really good, so a VPN is like, I'm sending a letter to somebody else. A VPN like puts my letter inside another envelope, right? Or another couple of envelopes. So if those envelopes are shady, or if they're like see-through, or they're like whatever, right? Not every like VPN envelope of security is the same. So you gotta do your research. And I don't know if usually I recommend folks get one that you actually pay money for, because that means that they're gonna maintain the back end from, you know, any type of, you know, prodding around or messing around that like hackers or surveillance or folks or anybody else can like look at and open up potentially.
Yeah, so as Jay said, like a VPN basically reroutes routes all of your internet activity through other servers so that it disguises your IP address, which is like an address that is identified with your Wi-Fi. So I personally use Proton VPN. They have a free one, and they have paid ones. It takes like less than 5 minutes to install, and you can use it on your computer and phones. I like it. I've also had Nord VPN recommended to me. Another one is called Express VPN, and Surfshark is another one. I will say, yeah, like Jay said, VPNs are not infallible, which is why we want to combine all of these different layers of safety. There have been times where different VPN services have been forced through legal means to disclose information about the users. And so if you really, really want to be careful, I would recommend using like either cash or secure cryptocurrency like Monero to get your VPN so that the VPN provider doesn't know who you are, so that they can't disclose that to law enforcement. However, this is all like really, really high level shit that most of us don't need to worry about. This is like if you're doing some really clandestine stuff that you want to be really careful about your anonymity. So yeah, I hope I'm not giving too much information that in a way that it is causing more fear, but I like to nerd out about these things.
No, thank you both. I think just the amount of different platforms that y'all shared, to me, it actually, and of course, like I've been in this realm of digital security, but when you share this many resources, I feel like it's like, okay, there's actually things that are, there are tools that are out here that are on our side. And just for a little bit of evidence of that, there have been several times that law enforcement has tried to force signal the SMS encryption to overturn information to police. And Signal has actively fought those attempts. So there are people who are creating beautiful tools out there to actually keep us safe and protected. So I think this is really helpful. And of course, it's always gonna bring up a lot of questions, and that's okay. We will answer what we can. And then, you know, we have all the time in the world to keep educating and learning. And so if it comes down to needing another webinar, we can do that. I do have a question for folks. I am answering some of the questions or just kind of repeating in type what encrypted browsers, search engine, email, storage drive, SMS, video chat, operating systems, and VPNs. Can you all see that? If you look at the Q&A, it should be under the answered. Okay, cool, yeah. All right, and I'll be trying to update those as we go, because it's helpful to have that, and y'all can just screenshot it. And if not, we'll just send it out in an email afterward. Thank you all so much. These are such beautiful, in-depth answers. And also, I just wanted to share, like, for folks who are on the call who might not understand, like, the context of, like, what spicy means, essentially just meaning, like, if you're talking about anything that might potentially incriminate you or make you appear to be maybe a target of surveillance, that's what spicy means. I know that's kind of like, I feel like that's like a very generational term right now, even though we're all from different generations maybe, but yes, spicy things stay encrypted. So it looks like we're approaching our bathroom time, which I think this is a good time to take a break before we head to our next question. So please use the restroom if you need to, get some food, hydrate, massage your eyeballs, stretch, do whatever you need to do, pet your cat. We can come back in 10 minutes. So that'll be, let's see, at 4:20 PT, 5:20, 6:20, and 7:20 Eastern time. Thank you all.
Nothing on us, island woman rise, walang makakatigil, brown, brown woman rise, alamin ang yung ugat, they got nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us, isang baksa. Yo, fuck a story arc, if it don't involve no matriarch, some mothers work from the ground up, they craft an air like ATR, with the butterfly sleeves, naka Philippine dana, pag nagsalita, mga banatay bala, wag magtaka kung ako ay makatabulok na sistema, kurakot sa pera, baksak, but we put in a heart into darkness, they put in these pigs in the office, oh, you thinking you're schooling, but you hella lost, cause you best see the boss while atop this, but look at my
my eye that she moving so cold. Can't hold a candle to her when she glow. Flick at the wrist with that elo she hold. Panagos the elo she dripping in gold.
We pulling up in a jeepney. All of my soldiers greet me. Hand me bandanas and pull back my hammer. It's warfare when you see me. Skin you alive for my country. I live and die for my country. I kill a pig in a white hooded suit on the low for my country. They got evil plans in the devil's hands, but I don't pray cause I organize. They got new ways to impose strength, but I teach mine how to mobilize. We don't fight for the money, for the greedy, for the white man. All we want is our freedom and the right to live on our motherland.
Island woman rise, walang makakatigil. Brown, brown woman rise, alamin ang yung ugat. They got nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us. Island woman rise, walang makakatigil. Brown, brown woman rise, alamin ang yung ugat. They got nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us. Isang baksak. Goddess of guerrilla warfare in every lifetime. We don't take no shit except an oppressor's lifeline. If you step out of your line, I will protect what's mine. Kahit merong rosaryo, sino magliligtas sa'yo? Puro dugo, pugot ulo, mulat sa dagat hanggang mundo. Proclaiming what's ours, the high and the low. These women are gods, you already know. Roots deeper than water, they're running a village. The river runs red, you'll be dead in a minute. Like Nevis Fernandez, have you beheaded? Fuck with my tribe, quickly regret it.
Abani ko sa kamay, alisang mikropono sabay. At ang tapang ko, kaya nanginay. At halimaw nang sumasabay. Mga baran nyo lahat sablay. Mga rappers na puro bangkay. Tinamaan ko lahat patay. Kaya walang mag-iingay. I got that Filipino phenotype. Kayo mangi mestizo white. But give me that moreno like. That Rufio or Kino type. My lolas they be speaking like. Those Bali songs and bolo knife. I breathe the ether, need no hype. Two tongues are sharper with the mic. I need no in my history like. From a land where greed is weaving tight. They thieve until one piece of might. Just turn to see no light. Hacienda like Aquino right. Rodrigo vigilante type. They kill my titles left and right. With smoke and mirrors fill the night.
So let it be known, if you don't already. Pinays have always been part and parcel, if not imperative and critical to the struggle. Filipinas are no strangers to wielding our own power. Of all the privileges that exist in this world, none of which you may be a benefactor of, there is at least one you bear, and that is the privilege of having been born a Filipina. Your DNA contains building blocks made from the mud of over 500 years of resistance and survival, and when you are ready, sis, we'll be right here, right here, right here.
Island woman rise, walang makakatigil. Brown, brown woman rise, alamin ang yung ugat. They got nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us. Island woman rise, walang makakatigil. Brown, brown woman rise, alamin ang yung ugat. They got nothing on us, nothing on us, nothing on us. Isang baksak.
Yeah, fool, you know how we do it. West side, coming from the west side, nothing but the west side. Ain't nothing going on but the bomb ass rap song, hitting all night long. Just like me on the black and white ivory, getting six on a titterly. You don't wanna see a G break your ass like dishes, buster ass tricks, sleep with the fishes, running from Lennox up at Venice. They wanna have me in stripes like Dennis the Menace, but that ain't poppin', ain't no stopping. Faux hopping, ass dropping, coup the bill, my troop can heal. Fool, I got skills, so back on up, boy, I check that chin. Down as fuck, and I'm full off hand. You gets no love, and I thought you knew it. Fool, you know how we do it. With the homie smelling a bud, double parked, and I'm talking to Dub about who got a plan, who got a plot, who got, and who got shot. Cause everybody knows that he got the info. Crazy tunes hanging out the window. Fool, I got them bomb ass tapes. The lynch mob, planet of the apes. I'm down with eight, and
what's up? Cam and Solo, they got nuts. When Ice Cube write a sentence, I want the bomb. Just like George Clinton, SKP is down to catch a body. Put on knee deep, we'll turn out your party. It gets no love, and I thought you knew it. Fool, you know how we do it. Jack me on a lick, cuz I'm that fool from South Central. You think you stuck yourself with a number two pin, so that's how I poke hot lead in your ass. With more bounce to the ounce and a dash, mash up Van Ness, headed for the west. Everything is great, slow down for the depth on 108. Keep mashing, don't drink and dry to keep the foe from crashing. Stashing the clock, and I thought you knew it. You know how we do it.
We were sitting out on the step, you know.
Ain't nothing to it. So what you gonna do around this?
Yo, man, I'ma go over here and get his brother, the man, and see what his head is all about.
I'm gonna say this one time, boy, and that's my word.
We rock a shot to knock fire through the Hindenburg.
The contribution is clear.
You add water to bone and get the Jurassic vibe on the microphone.
Now, if you like the tone
and how the harmony's done, and the sucker MCs die before they begun,
well, I'd like to know if you got the notion.
Cause we're number one.
I'm not trying to say my style is better than yours, I'm just on some other shit. I'm all about the beats and the lyrics, so when you hear it, you can feel it. The vibe is energized by the presence of my spirit.
No interference, we persevere.
All right, y'all, it is 5:20. I hope you had a restful break and enjoyed some of the bops. And we're going to move into our third question. Before I ask, Jay and May, are y'all there?
Yes.
Yep.
Sick. Cool. All right. Okay, so their question is, in what ways do you think that modern day organizers fail to stay safe while organizing?
Yeah, so one of the things that I see all the time is this thing, and it's so very, so very human, but like failing to do the easy things that we can do to protect ourselves because we're worried about the really scary, difficult things. And that's the biggest one for me. So I think this is a good time to talk about threat assessment. And really, like, threat assessment is like a fancy word that comes from our cybersecurity experts. But really, it's just thinking through what is the scenario that's actually happened to groups like yours, in places like yours, or to people in your network, right? What are the things that it's legit to be worried about, right? So is it actual government spying? Which government? The US government, right? Number two, is it a sketchy security contractor? Like we talked about, is it an undercover police officer, FBI agent, or private security officer? Is it local cops, you know, spying on you on the internet, probably Facebook? Or is it just regular phishing Trojan horses? And just a hint for folks, like number five is probably always the most likely thing to happen, right? It's much more likely that we're going to get our Facebook page hacked, right? And something that happens a little bit frequently, I see it a couple times a year, is somebody losing possession of their Facebook group, whether it's to a troll or to just a spammer happening, right? And the same security practices protect us from a lot of those things, right? So strong passwords, password management, and that includes for organizations, right? I still come across organizations that are managing their passwords in a Google Drive document. Not okay, my friends, right? I will literally help you fix that for free, all right? Just email me. And then not turning on two-factor authentication and or basically like using the same password for all of your organizational accounts. I run into that a whole lot, right? Please use different passwords. Not using messaging, you know, the end-to-end encrypted messaging apps, which are super easy to use these days. And then just leaving everything up on Google Drive all the time is something that I see a whole lot. But Google Drive documents, especially, like I take there is a great alternative. There are now alternatives to Google Drive, which is great. I saw a question about the Proton Drive situation. That's awesome. I kind of take the track that Google Drive is gonna happen. Folks are gonna use Google Drive. And so what I do is I go in and make sure that everything is sanitized off Google Drive after I have done my spicy stuff. And the way that I do that, we can go through it. And then the other thing, just to finish up that thought, is leaving location tracking on everything, right? So you can actually turn off location services when you're doing some spicy stuff on pretty much any device that you're using. But that's a big one for me. So with Google Drive, what I do is I take whatever document, if it needs to be like saved as a template, I'll take everybody's names off of it, any identifying information off of it, and then I'll make a copy of it. So that erases the history, right? Because you have to worry about in Google Drive the history. And then I'll trash it, and then I'll empty the trash. So things do stick around on the internet. Remember, once it's there, it's there. But Google, like think about it, Google can't save everything that's been in the trash, right? For, you know, a long period of time, right? They will eventually even have to dump whatever cached copy likely is in there. So that's the way that I handle Google Drive stuff. I think probably the best safest way to do it is to use an encrypted document sharing system to begin with. Check.
Cool, thank you for sharing all that, Jay. I feel like I'm learning a ton right now. How do people fail to stay safe while organizing? Definitely what Jay said, failing to do the easy things because the big things are too overwhelming. I feel that I've seen a lot of people, and I myself have also gone through like this two ends of the spectrum, one end being like, oh my God, everything is so scary. Everything that I do could be compromised. I feel stuck and, for lack of a better word, like paralyzed by fear. And so I think that is one way that people fail to stay safe, because if we're not doing what we need to do, we're not being safe. And you know, our enemies want us to be stuck in fear, to be stuck in insular formations, and to be overestimating the reach of surveillance. You know, they rely on us to be defeatist and to be policing ourselves. So that's one end of the spectrum. I think the other end of the spectrum is when people like learn about surveillance, and then it's so overwhelming that they find that it's just easier to just like be defeatist and just do nothing and be like, okay, everything can be compromised, might as well just do nothing. And I think that both of those are really dangerous, and that it is in, like Jay said, doing threat modeling, identifying what we're doing, what could go wrong, who our adversaries are exactly, and then like in a really systematic way, like identifying how we can mitigate those things. And it's kind of like a fancy term or whatever, but this is something that like you all already do. Like anyone who grew up in an abusive household, anyone who has dealt with like policing, anyone who is traumatized, like already knows how to do threat modeling. And so it's just taking that and applying it to our digital security. I would also say other ways that we fail to stay safe while organizing is allowing patriarchy, rampant patriarchy and misogyny to run loose in our movements. People's egos. I see people snitch on themselves a lot, whether that's through social media or through bragging about things that they've done unnecessarily. And when I say patriarchy, I mean like not necessarily that people who are exhibiting patriarchal behavior are necessarily informants, but it almost doesn't matter because they often end up doing the work of the state regardless in, creating divisiveness, abusing people, centering individuals over like decentralized approaches. So there's a really good zine called Why Misogynists Make Great Informants. I highly recommend this to everyone so that we can just be less scared about trying to identify individual informants and more so identifying patterns of behavior that are concerning. And finally, I think that we fail to stay safe by allowing for chronic burnout and just not resting and not taking care of each other. When I have not eaten or slept, I find myself very reactive. And I think conflict can destabilize our movements and cause lack of safety. Like if I'm in an interrogation room and I don't trust the people who are my co-defendants, I'm a lot more likely to say something that will be unsafe for all of us. And so I think really cultivating relationships of trust, relationships of care is the best thing that we can do for safety. Like if I know the allergies of the people I'm rolling with, if I know the PTSD triggers of the people I'm rolling with, like that will keep us safer than any email or tech that we have. That's like the bottom line that I want people to take away from this, is that community care is really the answer.
I think that's my favorite aspect so far of thinking about safety. And if people are interested in building community care networks, there is a lot of folks, disabled folks have been modeling this long before the pandemic ever happened. And there are some good resources that can help you to start having those intimate conversations with the folks that you're organizing with. And when I say intimate, I don't mean like romantically necessarily. I mean like learning each other's trauma, our PTSD, our triggers. That way we know how to take care of one another when shit hits the fan. Because that's when things start to fall apart. So thank you both. Let's hit the next question. What are some examples of good security practices that you would encourage organizers to incorporate into their work?
I would say it really depends. Jay and Courtney were teaching me yesterday the difference between security culture as a collective practice versus security practices as like individual ways that we move. And so good security practices really depend on what you're doing and what makes you feel safe. And that's different for everyone. So I can't give anyone a list or a formula. I just know it works for me. And I think that one thing that I've found a lot of solace and ease in is going very low tech sometimes. I'm pretty averse to technology. Like I've learned all of these things, but I feel safest when phones are just not around and I'm able to just have like a direct conversation with whoever I'm talking to. So I would recommend that people don't forget about things like radio and snail mail. And like just low-tech solutions is one thing that I would recommend.
Yeah, I love it. And we were having a conversation yesterday in our prep about different approaches to different situations. So for example, I think a really good one to go through is taking your phone to protest or not. I think that's a really kind of good example. There are a lot of folks who just go, don't take your phone to the protest, the end, right? When actually there's multiple, you know, different ways to approach that. I am also disabled. I have severe PTSD. And I might have a situation where I am completely discombobulated and I gotta call somebody to come help me. So I need to have a phone. Basically, there are other reasons, you know, why folks need phones for various different reasons. So taking the phone to the protest. So there are five things you can do that I wrote down here and five things that I do every time I take my phone to the protest. Number one is turn off your face ID. So if you have a phone, has face ID, all anyone has to do to unlock that is just hold it up to your face and it unlocks. So I turn that off right away. Leave the password on. So definitely have it password, definitely have it encrypted ahead of time. Number two is turn on your two-factor authentication for any app that you're gonna be using on your phone. Number three is use Signal for like those communications. And then, I'm reading the wrong thing. Number two is use a YubiKey. So one thing that has happened to me is having my phone confiscated by an officer. And I was doing a little civil disobedience. We were dropping a little banner. And what happened was they took my phone and they locked it up in evidence lockup for 9 months. So, which they were perfectly allowed to do while they were kind of deciding whether or not to charge us. Everything was fine. We did eventually get all of our stuff back, but 9 months later, right? So I do a lot of digital organizing. I was basically locked out of every single account I have because my phone was my two-factor. So if you do take your phone to the protest, make sure you have, again, it's called a YubiKey. I'll put in the website, but make sure you have a separate way that is not your phone to get into everything that you've two-factor authenticated, right? And then number three, if you helped organize the protest, remove any access to those planning documents from your phone, right? So say the police get a hold of your phone, right? That turns it potentially from a situation where you're in trouble to a situation where you and everybody else planning is in trouble, right? So one thing I can do is protect other people that may have planned by removing any of that stuff that might be on my phone. And I do that. And it's really easy especially with disappearing messages in Signal, to do that kind of stuff. And then make sure you encrypt and securely back up your phone and back it up onto a place that has encryption too, remember? And then to, again, shut off location tracking. So this goes for all devices at the protest, including your laptop and your backpack, including your Apple Watch, whatever it is, all track locations unless you turn it off. So make sure you do that. With location tracking, it does impact your GPS a little bit. You may not be able to use your GPS quite as well, but you know, at a big protest anyway, you're probably not gonna be able to use it because the network's gonna be jammed. So what I like to do is like take a paper map. I know, weird, right? But you can take a paper map, they work. You can also like print out a little map of just where you're going and like the metro stations or wherever. Whatever you need on it ahead of time, just as a backup. You can even do that for like if your phone gets broken or right, like falls in the toilet or whatever while you're there.
Thank you. These are good. I really appreciate that you broke that down into a couple of different steps. And Jay, if you get a chance, and I don't know if you have them like typed up or anything, but if you could copy and paste those, I think that'd be really helpful for people. No pressure though.
No, I got you.
Okay, cool. Because I am about to ask y'all another question. And this is gonna be the final question I ask until we have question and answer, which will take about 10 to 15 minutes at the very end, which is about my time. That will be 5:50. So 4:50, 5:50, 6:50, and 7:50 Eastern time. All right, so the next question we have is, in what ways does security culture permeate feelings of paranoia, scarcity, and isolation? And I'll put that in the chat too.
I think that, like, I'm reading this question as security culture being in quotations of, like, what a lot of people think security culture is, which is just, like, inherent distrust of people and platforms. And so I think it's really important for us to, like I was saying in response to the last question, to not allow ourselves to be siloed or stuck in these insular formations of just only working with the people that we already know. That's not safe because it's not effective. And like I was saying before, like, in order to be safe, we need to be doing what we need to do to get free. And so I think that it's important to, like, build with people that we don't know and to move at the speed of trust. And I think vibes are really important, and like the ways that we treat each other in the movement is really important, to offer each other grace and also directness, to try to get ahead of conflicts before they start. Because I think conflict is a huge, can be a huge vulnerability when it comes to safety and security. And also can be really transformative if we're approaching it from in a good way. So yeah, I don't know if that answers the question. That's kind of my thoughts on that.
I love it. Yeah. So I will say, and this has been in a lot of the spaces that I've come up in, this has been, you know, security culture is like as negative a term as it is potentially a positive term, because specifically this, you know, the fear and the paranoia and exactly, you know, how this question is written, the scarcity and the isolation literally interfere with the work, right? And that's when, you know, things especially to start getting really annoying for me is when literally, right, like we're paranoid about something happening and it's literally keeping us from doing the work. And that makes it, you know, that's essentially like it's already happened in a way, right? Like they've already won in a way at that point. And that frustrates me a lot. I think that one of the things that I'll share with you all is that never in my experience with informants or with government surveillance has anyone suspected the person. All right. So like, you know, this thing that we do where we're like, that person's a cop, right? Is so messed up and so often wrong, right? And I kind of liken it to this situation where it happens at almost every protest where the cops haven't shown up yet and somebody runs out of nowhere. Like, I don't know who these people are, but I've never seen them before, right? They come out of nowhere and they're like, the cops are coming, everyone, the cops are coming, right? And it's like, okay, who are you? Like, also, like, what? Like, right? It's just like, where is this random information coming from? And the impact of it, right? Like, there's the information and there's like the emotional, psychological impact is just fear, right? Which is not exactly for humans. Things don't, you know, we don't get super logical when we're super scared and paranoid about stuff. It's not exactly an orientation that leads us to use our analytical minds. It sort of like leads us to use, you know, the really important, you know, thing that I'm in touch with all the time, my PTSD, I call it my lizard brain. But right, it's the thing that throws you out of the way of an oncoming car, right? And it kind of like exists even before you can consciously think about it, right? When that part of my brain is activated, literally there's, you know, there's neuroscience to back this up now, but the analytical part of our brains is not functioning as well, right? It's not the clearest voice, and in a way to survive, it doesn't need to be, right? But there are ways that we can have these conversations without having that fear and our kind of like lizard brains in the driver's seat the whole time, right? Like obviously like have the feelings and feel the feelings all the time. But I think that when we get into this space where those feelings are leading us to policy and what tools to use or not, that, you know, we need to kind of take a step back and just kind of think about the culture that we're creating and where the fingers are pointing and what's happening there.
I really love that last part that you said, Jay, about the culture we're creating, right? Because we're all here in this webinar because we want to learn more about how to avoid surveillance, like how to not be targeted, how to not get caught, if we're doing things that are incriminating, which is just about everything under the sun if they want to incriminate you, right? At the same time that we're here to try to resist that and fight against it, in our attempt to organize, we're also creating culture, right? And we don't want to create the culture that we're currently living in, which is a heavily surveilled, we live under heavy surveillance. And we have for a long time, especially post 9/11. And we don't want to recreate that type of dynamic amongst the people that we are supposed to be building trust with, amongst the people that we are trying to survive with, right? Like that is not, it doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel healthy to not be able to trust the people around you. And so I think that's really the core of that last question, right? Is the ways that sometimes security culture is, can be co-opted or just wielded in a way that makes it really difficult for us to get the work done, as May and Jay both just eloquently described for us all. So, and also, you know, we're living in capitalism. It's really hard to remember that we have abundance. And I don't say that in like a, I don't want to say that in a way that's, you know, undermining people's real lived experiences, but we get to choose who we want to organize around and with, and we get to consciously build trust with those people. And I think that this kind of ties back into creating care networks. And when we try to organize through a disability framework, it's really, really good at countering a lot of this fear, anxiety, paranoia, and scarcity, because disability framework teaches us that we have to build relationships with people around us in really intimate ways so that we can get our needs met so that we can survive, right? And I say this as someone who has bipolar 1 and really desperately needs to have a really strong core support around me. If we can understand what brings each of us to this movement, and we know what our stake is in it, and we know what kind of situations we have capacity to show up for and what kind of situations we don't, if we know what type of medicines the people around us need, what type of medication folks need, right? It's those nitty gritty details that a lot of us don't share that information with people we organize with, but we need to start, because these are people that we are trying to build trust with. And it's once you start to understand in depth, right? Like you would with close friends or family or partners. That's when you really start to build trust with folks. And that trust really is grounding. Like, I can't describe how grounding it feels to know, oh, this person knows so much about me. I know that they can show up for me in times of crisis. Even outside of organizing against late stage fascism, these things are important for you as an individual, but also for our collective liberation, right? Because as we begin to learn more about one another, build those relationships, we're starting to grow the communities that we need to make the state obsolete. So when it comes down to it, personally, I think that community care networks are incredibly important to our collective liberation. And I suggest y'all start getting intimate with yourselves, understanding who you are and what you need to be in this movement. I think that's what's really going to save us. So let's do it. It's 5:45. We've got a lot of questions here. We'll see how many we can get to.
Can I add one thing before we move on? Just on this topic, I really appreciate what both of you have said. And I think it also, I want to bring into the conversation, like, the difference between anonymity and privacy. I think a lot of times people get confused about these things, especially when, like, first starting out on trying to be more secure, is like, okay, no one can know who I am. I need to be hella anonymous. Like, but I just want to kind of note the distinction, which is that anonymity is like, people know what you're doing, but not who you are. And privacy is like, people know who you are, but not all that you're doing. And I think that it's important to have like a good balance between these things. And like you were saying, Courtney, like, there's safety in people knowing and grounding in people that you trust knowing so much about you that they can keep you safe. And sometimes there also can be safety in being known, because it's really hard for the state to disappear someone who is well known. Whereas someone who, like, no one knows their legal name, no one knows how to find them if they become incarcerated, or no one knows their family, like, that person's really easy to get disappeared. And so it's up to us to like find a balance of what feels safe for us and like who around us knows what, and just finding balance in all of that. So I just wanted to say that before we move on.
Thank you for adding that, because I think that's especially important, especially in the digital age where we see some people do have, maybe it's a lot of clout, right, in their community for the organizing they do. And it does offer a lot of safety. And so these are a lot of things that you have to reconcile with, especially because, and it leads perfectly into the question that I'm going to give some space for. Because we're trying to organize in a way that's very different than we did pre-pandemic. Right, we had to do a lot of things, maybe digitally. Like right now, we're learning over a Zoom webinar. So a lot of folks are being challenged with having to put themselves in digital spaces that might not be safe. So this is a great question from Callum. Thank you for asking. It says, for those wanting to get involved with or create activism groups but are newer to activism, how can we find other activists to team up with while staying safe using technology to find people?
I would say don't start looking for activists, start looking for people who you have affinity with or have shared interest or stake with. I think that it's a mistake for us to always start by looking for other community organizers, because there's a lot of just everyday people who, you know, can become organizers or who have other skills that are also important to build with. So that's where I would start with that.
Exactly. The only thing I'd add is that there are, you know, look for folks who have values who are similar to yours, right? Look for those folks who are espousing those values in whatever ways, you know, are appropriate to that thing, right? One of the ways that I like to look for internet friends is finding folks who are like in the friends of friends are always nice too, but looking for folks who are talking about their values in spaces that are just in social media or Twitter, right? And remember that this is something I had to learn with my PTSD, but right, like your trust does not have to be an immediately open door. And in fact, that's probably not, you know, the best thing to do, right? You can exercise judicious trust of people where you open the door a little bit and like get to know them a little bit. And if that's okay, then you crack the door open a little bit more, right? So it doesn't necessarily have to like, you know, be somebody that you're telling all of the spicy things to immediately, right? We can build up that relationship over time. And I might just be somebody who like shares a hobby with you. I think like, I like to find people who like Star Trek, because typically folks who like Star Trek like are like, you know, there's some values there. Although you always see those folks on the internet who are like, what, activism in Star Trek? That's so wrong. When it's like obviously canon from the get-go, right? But you know, finding folks who like media and cultural commentary that you watch and like are not only like, that's not only a great way to do it, but that's also ways that like, you know, the internet is friendly for doing that as well.
Totally. Going off of that too, around what you were saying, Jay, about trust, I think that just keeping things on a need to know basis, you know, some things are like people just don't need to know unless they need to know. And I think that's a really good like way to move.
Like where you live immediately, right? Is that what you're kind of talking about, that stuff?
Or just like what you're saying about trust, like just because you trust someone doesn't mean it's an open door to like everything that you've ever done and everyone that you know and everything they've ever done. Like there's some things that just don't need to be discussed. And like maybe I meet someone and I feel comfortable bringing them into my home, but that doesn't mean that they need to like know everything that all my roommates do, or, you know, just things like that. Just using discretion, which you all know already.
Thank you. Yes. Like if you do something incriminating, like you don't have to tell the whole world. Or are you going to figure out ways to make yourself anonymous in those sharings that you do? Jay, I really love the idea of connecting with people based off media. for me for the last couple years, it's been connecting with folks who have been reading Octavia Butler, because I feel like they're already in some, they're on some wavelength of understanding how to build our skill sets for a long, sustainable resilience. Let's see, we got another question on here that I thought was really good, and just, I think, pretty simple to answer, we'll see. But should you use your real name when signing up for things like Signal, Proton Mail, etc.?
It depends on your situation. My instinct is to say no, but there's times, depending on who you are, where it's safer to use your real name and for people to know who you are. I have a comrade named Ramsey Orta, who is a cop watcher and is pretty well known. And I asked him, I was like, how do you deal with like being so public and the cop, just being in the cop space all the time, everyone knowing your legal name? And he said, there's safety in people knowing exactly who I am and knowing how to find me. And so that if I experience repression, that it's easier to get support. Whereas maybe there's some factors of your life or of your loved ones that you don't want anyone to know your legal name. Like, it's completely up to your own situation and what makes you feel comfortable.
Yeah, I would just add that it also depends on what your legal name is. If your legal name is really common, right? You know, it's harder to see. Oh, is that that person? Versus if it's really uncommon. The other thing I'll just say is that if we only use things like Tor for spicy stuff, or we only use things like Signal for spicy stuff, then everybody gonna know that only this, the, if they wanna find the spicy stuff, to go there, right? So it's actually kind of important sometimes to mix in perfectly legitimate activities in a strategic way, so that there's just like more data that everybody got to comb through to find the spicy stuff, right?
Thank you. And on the topic of counter surveillance, we have a really good question here. Do you have advice for doing research into the surveillance practices of your local police department in order to do more accurate threat assessment?
Ooh, yes, I love this one. Yes. Okay. So the first thing I would suggest is, I don't know if y'all noticed, but police departments are like really into Facebook these days. That's why I said Facebook earlier, but like somehow they all just decided that like they were going to be really technologically inclined. And that means being on Facebook. You can kind of hear a little bit of, you know, a certain generation there, right? But like they're all over Facebook. And so I like to watch their Facebook pages. I like to see how they got the information that they got. I like to see what exactly they're focusing on. And from there, you can kind of infer some of what they're, you know, doing to watch folks.
Yeah, I don't have much to add. Local police is not like my main adversary in the work that I do. So I don't have a whole lot of experience researching them. But for similar stuff like correctional officers, definitely Facebook, Twitter sometimes.
You can also, especially with city departments, have to have some level of what they're buying public. So you can actually look through some of those records at times to see what equipment and, you know, what their purchasing habits, right, are looking like. And you can also see, like, another thing I like to do is see who's purchasing what anti-crowd devices these days. Is always really helpful to know, like, are we going to have an LRAD, you know, at the protest, you know, what's going to potentially happen and go down. And then the other thing is talk to folks who have experience with whatever, you know, forces of authority are going to potentially be in the area as well. There are always folks out there to talk to, either folks who've done protests in the past, or, you know, your local like needle exchange folks have to deal with, you know, law enforcement all the time too, right? There are folks, and your local domestic violence advocates have to deal with that kind of stuff all the time. There may be local knowledge that's only like a step away, you know, within your you know, aligned humans within your network that you can also talk to and get intel on what's going on.
Yes, that's a great answer. It reminds me a lot of doing some mutual aid work with unsheltered folks when I was living in Kitlani, Flagstaff, so-called Flagstaff, Arizona, just by accident. I learned a lot about the surveillance attempts by police there. Just by driving around doing routine mutual aid, it was really easy to see that police were following us around to figure out where unsheltered people were. So we learned a lot about their surveillance of unsheltered folks just by the nature of being followed everywhere we went. And yeah, very quickly realizing that they were picking up on our route and how dangerous that actually was for the community we were trying to help out. So there's a lot of like really indirect ways you can like just collect data about surveillance. But there is a lot of cop watch organizers out there who have a lot of great techniques for this and a lot of great ways to collect data and store data. So definitely look into cop watch if you have one locally, or maybe you're interested in starting one. This brings us really close to the end. So we have about 2 minutes left. We weren't able to get to all of these questions, but I think that this is just evidence of the fact that we need to have another webinar. So I'm gonna screenshot all of these and we can do a deeper dive at another time. And of course, everybody is invited. And I do appreciate the questions, so I apologize if we couldn't get to them in time. Hopefully some of these will be answered in this resource document that I put together with the help of Jay and May. I'm gonna drop the link. But you also can all head to the PowerShift Network Instagram if you don't get a chance to do this right away. On our Instagram, you can go to the link in bio, and I've already uploaded a document with just 5 links on there that you can follow and just learn a little bit more about some of the things we talked about today, including some of the resources that were shared. And I think that they're really helpful. Let's see. Okay, here it comes. It's a bit.ly link. That's the link that you can follow. And if you don't save it now, it will be on our link in bio on Instagram. And it's also gonna get posted on Instagram too, so no rush. But thank you, Jay, and thank you, May, for sending those along to me and just giving me something to share with folks afterward. It's not the prettiest graphic, so bear with me, all right? I made it very quickly today before this happened. But yeah, that brings us to a close. This was really good. There's so much information shared. I'm sure everyone's going to leave here with a really full brain. So please take some rest away from screens and allow your brain to stew over everything. And if you have questions, you are always welcome to email PowerShift Network. You can always go to the Instagram DMs as well. I am social media lead, so I will see them and I will answer you. And I'm always looking for more engagement. So if y'all have questions lingering, just let me know. And then May and Jay, if y'all want to, you're welcome to share your contact information. If you feel like doing that, there's no pressure because that can be incapacitating as well. So, but I just want to thank you all for coming and thank you for sharing so much about personal experience too, because I know that can be quite heavy and triggering. So, please do what you need to take care of yourselves tonight. And thank you for blessing our little online community with so much knowledge. I'm very grateful.
Thank you all. Everybody keep up the good work.
Yeah, thank you so much, everyone. I'm so grateful.
Cool, thank you all.